It's a genuine pleasure for me to welcome my dear friend Chuck Vest back to MIT. It's an honor, really. Chuck, come on up and tell us something. Yeah.
Thank you. Philip, I love you dearly, but I don't set your salary anymore. You can give me the brief introduction the next time. That means an awful lot to me, seriously. For those of you who are appropriately here primarily to step outside, as John said, to observe luminous windows, etc., I'm led to remember a true story. Somebody I knew all the way back in the 60s, an academic, social scientist, gave a talk at a Rotary Club or some such thing in a small town in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. And the person that introduced him after dinner said the following: "I'd like to introduce Professor X. He's a socialist." And then he said, "But you should stick around and listen to him, because after he's finished, we have some live entertainment." So a little bit that spirit. After you listen to me, there will be some artistic entertainment. I am just really privileged and very happy to be back here at MIT. This is my first time to be in this new wonderful portion of the MIT Museum, bringing it close to the fruition that Warren and so many people dreamed about for years. And John, I'm very grateful for your very active leadership. I certainly want to thank my good friend and a person I really do adore, Philip Corey, for all that he continues to do for MIT, and also to thank Seth Ruskin, who has put all of this together for us. I was also hoping to thank Jeannie Benton, but I don't think I've detected her here. I was hoping she would be here. Maybe she'll be in tomorrow, but another wonderful, wonderful member of our community. Well, Philip pointed out that I'm now working for the National Academy of Engineering in Washington, and this last year we had a little exercise where we got together a little over a dozen of really the most incredibly innovative and creative and accomplished engineers, a few scientists, at least one medical doctor, and asked them to sort of lock themselves in a room and come up with a set of grand challenges that were things they felt engineers could accomplish in the next one or two decades of this century that would make life on Earth better and that were really doable. No pie in the sky, things you think could really be done. This group was chaired by Bill Perry, Stanford professor, former Secretary of Defense of the United States in the Clinton administration. It had at least two MIT faculty members engaged. Wes Harris, Bob Langer were part of this. We had Craig Venter, Jane Lubchenco, who's just been named to be the new director of NOAA in Washington. We had one of the Google twins, Dean Kamen, all these kind of really very imaginative yet people who still deliver the hardware or the product. So they came up with 14 challenges. I'm not going to tell you what they all are, but they basically fit into four buckets, one having to do with energy and environment and sustainability, defense against global change, a second group having to do with the role of engineering in medicine, modern medicine, and in the delivery of health care in hopefully more efficient and effective ways to larger numbers of people, a group that had to do with keeping us secure against both man-made threats and natural threats, and then finally, of course, the best part of all, some things really having to do with just expanding human capability and creation of joy. So a group of deans around the country kind of picked this up, and the first 2 days of this week, I was at Duke University, where we had almost 1,100 people, about half students and half faculty, a few folks from industry and government, to talk about these challenges and how we can better use them to educate engineers and to attract young women and men into our field. And the reason I'm bringing all of this up is that the main outcome of that meeting was that we're going to fan out across the country and create a group of undergraduate Grand Challenge scholars. And these will be young men and women who will, first of all, be obviously committed to studying engineering and getting some project and research experience as undergraduates, but who also will commit to studying in a more highly interdisciplinary way and joining together their engineering knowledge with other fields such as political science, ethics, business law, human behavior, medicine, art, the sciences, and so forth, around some coherent theme having to do with one of these grand challenges facing humankind. So this has kind of been a week in which I've had a chance to be into very different venues, being inspired by truly interdisciplinary kinds of work. But we're here at MIT today to celebrate and salute a very different activity built around the science and technology and art of holography that has for 50 years now, 60 years actually, crossed traditional academic and social boundaries for somewhat deeper human purposes, especially creating very interesting amalgams of art and technology. Holography has enabled artists, scientists, and engineers to produce, of course, stunningly realistic three-dimensional images, to produce stunning clear images of things that obviously can't actually exist, and to create wonderful images that enable us literally to see the unseen. Now, optical holography, as we know it today, was largely developed by three great pioneers: Emmett Leith of the University of Michigan, Yuri Denisyuk of Russia's Yoffe Institute, and our own dear Steve Benton of MIT. They, in turn, as most of you know, built on the work of the physicist Dennis Gabor. Leith, Denisyuk, and Benton established a fundamentally different way of working with light. Their discoveries and inventions brought us three-dimensional imaging, a variety of ways of processing optically encoded information, and new means of visualizing and measuring various physical phenomena. Steve Benton, of course, was not only an important and pioneering contributor to these developments, but he dramatically broadened the communities of interest in holography, expanding the conceptual base to a much more general view of three-dimensional imaging and working to bring holography from the age of film into the digital age. Holography's importance, I think, is attested to by its continuing ability to inspire and excite those who encounter it for the first time. Few, if any, other scientific concepts or technologies of the second half of the 20th century are so readily accessible in their basic form to those with little formal scientific or engineering training. Young children continue to marvel at floating three-dimensional images that they encounter in science museums, in school science projects, and even in souvenir and jewelry shops. My own association with holography stems from my days as a faculty member at the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor, but I am pleased to have played a bit part in making it possible for our MIT museum to steward what is the most important collection of holograms in the world. But the real heroes of this endeavor were Steve Benton and Jerry Wiesner, who conceived and carried out the idea of acquiring the collection of the Museum of Holography in New York at auction when it closed. The story of the auction itself is very interesting, as a few of you know, but in essence, we got the collection because much of the bidding actually ceased when it was recognized that only MIT would keep the collection intact. So we therefore have a special stewardship of these treasures and those that have followed them. I therefore take particular joy in this evening. So what was my role? Well, it was pretty minor. I backstopped the financial effort by guaranteeing that MIT would support the purchase if we were unable to raise the necessary money. Fortunately, we raised the necessary money, so I never got in trouble with the trustees. I also, ask Emmett Leith and Yuri Shupatnik, my former colleagues at Michigan, if they would contribute their incredibly important pioneering holograms to our cause, which they did. But the real credit, again, belongs primarily to Steve Benton and to Jerry Wiesner, both of whom we all miss very much. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about the early days of holography from my own experience. My view of the early days of holography is literally and figuratively from the fringes. I came to work at the Willow Run Radar and Optics Laboratory at the University of Michigan to learn if it was possible to unlock the quantitative information in the fringes of holographic interferograms. So my work was not at the heart of holography per se, but it followed closely enough after the pioneering advances that I was privileged to work with many of the real pioneers and to appreciate the environment. I want to emphasize that the environment that they developed in their laboratories that enabled all of this to happen. I believe I first learned about holography in the 1960s when Robert Powell, an African-American scientist with Boston roots, who was then working also at Michigan's Willow Run Laboratory, presented a seminar in our Department of Mechanical Engineering. At that time, I was a graduate student in the department focusing on the thermal sciences, that is, on thermodynamics, heat transfer, fluid mechanics, things like that, nothing having to do with optics. The seminar presented by Bob Powell reviewed the fundamental concept of the formation of holograms and dramatically showed that interference fringes could be formed by juxtaposing light emanating from the actual light source with the holographically reconstructed waves that appeared to emanate from an image of the same source. I also attended a major press and public briefing on the new field of three-dimensional holographic images that was presented by Emmett Leith and Yuri Shupatnik in Michigan's Rackham Graduate School building. The impact on that audience was just enormous. Not only was three-dimensional imagery totally amazing, but lasers were sufficiently new that the vast majority of the audience had never seen a laser before. After the briefing, several now famous holograms, especially that of the model train, were on display. This was an amazing event, and several of the holographic images suddenly became very famous, in large part due to the outstanding photographs of them made by the great scientific photographer Fritz Goro, who published them in Life magazine. That is actually how the vast majority of the world learned about optical holography. Later, in about 1968, I was in the final stages of my PhD work on a problem in a field called hydrodynamic stability of natural convective flows when I decided to accept an offer to become an assistant professor in mechanical engineering at the University of Michigan. This work that was mostly theoretical was done under the supervision of an excellent mentor, Professor Vedat Arpachi. But because I would be joining the faculty of the same department in which I had studied, I thought it would be important to move into new intellectual territory rather than continue the same directions that my supervisor was pursuing. Thinking about Bob Powell's seminar, the general excitement in those days of lasers and holography, and the now somewhat more prevalent work on holographic interferometry that was just beginning, I sought to work half-time in the radar and optics lab to determine if this new technique could become an important experimental tool for mechanical engineering research, especially in these fields I call the thermal sciences. The lab director, the late Bill Brown, and Emmett Leith readily agreed and made this possible. So I became the only mechanical engineer in this group of physicists and electrical and radar engineers. So very early on, I began to learn both the joy and the value of crossing traditional disciplinary boundaries. It was in this way that I came close to the early developments of holography, close in both space and time, but I certainly was not at its center, nor present at its actual inception. The pioneering work in holography at the University of Michigan Will Run Laboratories was made possible by intersections, intersections of ideas, intersections of technologies, and above all, intersections of remarkable people, together with a good dose of serendipity. Most lay people, and indeed scientific and engineering professionals, learned about holography the same way I did. They read or heard about this amazing new technique for producing realistic, three-dimensional images of everyday objects using laser light. The reality is that those who actually developed holography did not intend to make images of everyday objects, and they did their initial work before lasers were available, something that has been lost in the mists of history for most people. The physicist Dennis Gabor first worked out the concept of what was called, and quite appropriately, wavefront reconstruction, or holography, in an attempt to make improved images by electron microscopy, not by light optics. Today, we would refer to Gabor's technique as in-line holography, and we would all recognize that as an optical imaging technique, it was pretty lousy because it suffered from the fact that the reference wave and the reconstructed wave propagated along the same collinear path. Because of this juxtaposition, holography remained mostly a curiosity. However, the concept and experiment were sufficiently original and potentially important that Gabor received the Nobel Prize in Physics for it in 1971. But it remained for Emmett Leith and his colleague, Joris Upetniks, to separate the reference wave from the reconstructed wave by placing a substantial angle between the reference and reconstructed waves. And that, of course, is the idea that, like so many scientific ideas that are really important, is extremely simple in retrospect, but was actually quite remarkable. Like Gabor, Leith and Upetniks did not set out to do three-dimensional optical imaging. They were radar engineers. And remember, this was the middle of the Cold War. They were radar engineers, and they were also familiar with the new field of communication theory. They worked to develop coherent radars capable of high-precision imaging. To develop the necessary concepts, they explored the use of optical analogs to coherent radars. This got them to thinking about Gabor's technique of optical holography. If they could separate the reference wave from the object wave, they could build a laboratory-scale optical experiment to serve as an analog model of coherent radars. In this way, the intersection of optics and communication theory, which prior to that had nothing to do with each other, came about. So the development of off-axis holography came from the intersection of optics and communication theory. But if it were not for the serendipitous development and commercialization of helium neon lasers at just about the same time, the limited coherence of mercury vapor light sources would have restricted off-axis holography to being a minor laboratory curiosity. So the intersection now of lasers and off-axis holography gave us a new tool for science, for engineering, and for art. It turns out that it also led to a major delay in the availability of holography. And here I'm going to tell you a little inside story that I find very few people know. It turns out that there was this major delay, and here's why. During the same period that Leith and others at Willow Run Laboratories were engaging in developing the techniques for optical processing of radar images, this optical processing idea, was very seminal work, and it dramatically improved the ability of radars borne by aircraft to image objects, what we would now call synthetic aperture techniques. But extracting the image from the raw data was a monumental problem in those days because computers had only very, very modest computing power. optical data processing techniques, especially after the availability of lasers, was a huge advance and presumably a major advantage to the United States vis-a-vis the Soviet Union. This, as I said, was at the height of the Cold War, and because of national security concerns, the fact that radar engineers were working with laser optics was highly classified. For this reason, there was a very substantial time lag between the time in which Leith and Upitniks actually did their early work in off-axis holography and when it was published and made available in the open literature. In the late 60s and 70s, there were many remarkable faculty and researchers working in the radar and optics lab at Michigan. I was fortunate to know many of them. We also had remarkable graduate students in the lab in the early 70s, people such as Rod Alfrenes, who today is the chief scientist of Bell Labs, Don Winter, who's currently the U.S. Secretary of the Navy, and my own graduate student, Don Sweeney, who has had a very productive career, first at Purdue University, but mostly at Lawrence Livermore Laboratory, and especially well known for his work in the field of ultraviolet lithography. But the holography pioneer who most influenced and enabled my own work was Carl Stetson. Carl had left the radar and optics lab just about the same time I arrived there to go to work in the new settings of an industrial laboratory, mostly at the Ford Scientific Laboratories and later near here in Connecticut at United Technologies Research Center. His was the most seminal and comprehensive view of the field of holographic interferometry. When I began doing some of my research, my primary interest, as I have said, was not in the motion of solid, opaque objects, which most people were paying attention to, but rather in the measurement of three-dimensional temperature and density fields, hence my word, making the unseen seen, finding ways first of visualizing this. This was not of much interest to the mission of the laboratory, but the open-minded people who ran it enabled me to start this work. But to earn my keep, I was assigned to be the principal investigator on a rather large project that was sponsored by ARPA, the Advanced Research Project Agency, on the use of optical holographic interferometry for the non-destructive testing of solid objects, especially for the detection of subsurface cracks and voids, things to make sure aircraft fuselages are intact, things like that. So in 1971, I was sent to an ARPA contractors meeting here at the Watertown Arsenal, just outside Boston. As I was driving along Storrow Drive on my way to that meeting across the river from MIT, literally, not exaggerating, I was listening to the local news. And what did I hear but the announcement that Jerome Wiesner, formerly President Kennedy's science advisor, had just been elected the 13th president of MIT. Now, let me tell you that in my wildest dreams, I could not have imagined that 19 years later, I would have the privilege of becoming MIT's 15th president. Carl Stetson, who I referred to, likes to paraphrase General MacArthur and say that old holographers never die, they just become incoherent. And I have to tell you that as a dedicated teacher and researcher in 1971, I would have considered the thought that someday I would be a university president as proving that Carl was exactly right. But such is life. Now, I last saw Emmett Leith at a celebration many of you know well, that Nicholas Negroponte and I hosted here at MIT in honor of Steve Benton at the Media Lab. And as you know, Steve passed away literally the day before this extraordinary meeting. Emmett Leith was there. Yuri Denisyuk was there. Within 1 year, all three of these great pioneers died. It just was an incredible thing to think about. Steve, who, as Philip said, invented the rainbow hologram, was another remarkably creative pioneer. He was also a teacher's teacher, And above all, he built remarkably important bridges between the holography community and the arts community. The holography art connection also played a role in the early days of holography and gave rise to incredible things that could have happened only in the 60s and 70s. I think especially of Lloyd Cross, who had worked on lasers and masers at Willow Run Lab and then later in the defense industry, but chucked it all in and went on to work on multiplex holograms and found the San Francisco Holography School, which was essentially a commune devoted to holography. They decided in this commune that they didn't very much like metal, so they fashioned surprisingly accurate things like anamorphic lenses for the scientists and engineers here by mounting clear plastic pillowcases filled with silicone in wooden fixtures and painstakingly adjusting them until they had just the right optical properties. I once visited the School of Holography together with Emmett Leith and Steve Benton, and my great claim to fame, I actually met Pam. How many of you know who Pam is? Pam is the woman blowing the kiss in the famous rotating hologram that thousands and thousands of people have seen. So in closing, let me just comment that the role of art and the humanities, but let's focus largely on art at MIT, is really very special, something very much to be treasured. Many of us do not feel that even yet that role is strong enough. But it is here, it is clearly part of what makes MIT, MIT. And today, as I go around the country visiting other institutions with lots of engineering and science, they are just now beginning to create programs that merge technology and science and art. And frankly, they're doing very much what MIT was doing 10, 20, 30, 40 years ago, with the history of CAVS, the Media Lab, our wonderful arts programs across the whole institution. These are really something to be treasured. And the last little reflection I want to leave with you in this regard, and I hope I'm not tramping on any toes here, but I've discovered the last 15 years as I've gone around the world to universities in Europe, universities in Asia, where there's a strong focus on engineering and science. When I tell them how important the arts are to making MIT what it is, I'm met with blank stares. Most people just do not understand that. But I believe it is a very important, to use today's vernacular, it's a very important comparative advantage that we in the United States have, that our engineers and scientists are generally educated and live for some period of their lives within a milieu where they mix with artists, with social scientists, with humanists, and so many others. And I just cannot imagine MIT without a strong arts program, and so I'm especially privileged to be here this evening and be part of one little additional step forward and upward on that journey to make an even more important home for the arts at MIT. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. So Chuck has agreed to take some questions or comments if any of you, yes, please.
Not huge, and I would really need to check my facts, but I'm saying that I'm suspecting there was at least a five-year lag, and some of the more technical aspects of their work really were not published for many years after that. But so it wasn't huge, but it would have happened a little faster.
Pinpoint a year.
Pardon?
A year.
I would have to go back and check the record. Shouldn't be hard to do because Emmett wrote a paper that I'm pretty sure was clear up into the 70s or 80s in one of the IEEE journals, in which he sort of went back over this whole history. And I think you could probably fix the dates from that. And I don't think it was huge, but it may have been as much as 4 or 5 years.
Is the story true that actually Emmett had accidentally discovered the off-axis configuration by incremental experimentation? It was not really something that was thought out. It was something that happened somewhat serendipitously.
I think that it is absolutely accurate to say that Emmett made his discovery, if you will, thought through this off-axis business in a pretty disciplined technical manner. But the history, especially of holographic interferometry, the development and use of fringes, that was discovered by probably a dozen different people around the world, mostly by accident. But I think the off-axis idea that they had came from pretty straightforward technical thinking.
Anyone else? Okay, they're probably waiting for tomorrow, Chuck.
No, they're waiting for the live entertainment.
So. Wine or something. We can continue informally. I want to thank one. Not only have you given us a wonderful kind of historical retrospective as a historian, I just love trees, but you know, you work with someone many, many years, and then you learn a little more about their professional lives. And I learned a lot this evening about you and what you were doing back in those days at Michigan that I didn't know enough about. So I'm grateful. I think we all are. So a round of applause.
Thank you.